The chapter on enzymes has a lot of descriptive material, very interesting material though, because it applies to living systems and explains lots of interesting facts about how our organisms survive. One of the topics in this chapter, factors that affect enzyme activity. There are a number of factors that do affect how efficiently enzymes work, and we'll mention four of those. The first of these is enzyme concentration. We know that it's necessary for the enzyme and substrate to come together to form a complex, and then that complex breaks down and gives us product. So it makes sense that we need both enzyme and substrate there. Over here I've drawn a graph where the rate is on the vertical axis, and down here on the horizontal axis is the enzyme concentration. And as you might expect, at time zero, without any enzyme present, the rate is going to be zero. And what this graph says is that as we add enzyme, the reaction goes faster and faster. So the line rises in this fashion. And you might, looking at this equation, say, well, I don't understand why the rate continues to increase, because after a while the substrate concentration is going to decrease. The enzyme will use up the substrate. And that's true. Keep in mind though that this isn't a progression of time down here. What we're really looking at is the initial rate. In other words, we've got a beaker, it's got some substrate in it, we add some enzyme, and we measure that burst of speed right at that initial point. How fast does the reaction go? We don't measure the rate 10 minutes later or 20 minutes later, but just that initial velocity. And we get a graph like this. Let's look at the effect of substrate concentration on rate. Here again, we have rate on the vertical axis. On the horizontal axis this time, substrate concentration. And we're looking at the initial rate. We just add the substrate in and measure that burst of speed. How fast does the reaction progress? And we're not looking at its rate 10 minutes later or 20 minutes later. And we'd actually conduct a series of experiments. Maybe we've got a whole series of beakers set up. In the first beaker, we add so much substrate. In the second beaker, we add a little more substrate. In the third beaker, a little more still. And we measure each of those initial velocities. And what we find is that as we add substrate, the reaction goes faster and faster. Well, you might expect that, because enzyme and substrate are coming together and producing product. But what we find is that the curve reaches a maximum. The curve slopes off, or plateaus, and we've reached some sort of maximum velocity at that point. How can we explain that? Well, if we've got if we're in this experiment, we're varying substrate concentration, but enzyme concentration is fixed. There's a certain number of active sites on that fixed amount of enzyme. And once all of those active sites are occupied by substrate, even though there's more substrate, the enzyme can't work any more efficiently. So it plateaus, and we've reached that maximum velocity. Let's look at the effect of temperature. Down here's another graph. Again, rate is up here on the vertical axis. This time we're increasing temperature as we proceed to the right. And we notice that we get an incline, a line going up, and then it sort of drops off precipitously. This is a graph that we would find for an enzyme-catalyzed reaction. If it wasn't enzyme-catalyzed, but a typical inorganic reaction, we might find that that line just keeps on going. The more we increase temperature, the faster the reaction goes. That's because the molecules are traveling around faster, they're more effective collisions, and the reaction just goes faster and faster. But this time, with an enzyme-catalyzed reaction, we find out that there's a limit. There's an optimum temperature, and then the curve drops off. The reaction goes slower and slower. How can you explain that? Well, we know that enzymes are proteins, and proteins are susceptible to changes in temperature. And over here, probably protein denaturation is occurring. And as the enzyme loses that specific structure, it can no longer catalyze the reaction, and so the reaction goes slower and slower. Let's look at the effect of pH. This curve reminds us of the temperature curve. Maybe it doesn't drop off as precipitously over here on the right-hand side, but at low pHs and high pHs, enzymes typically don't work very well. That's because we know that enzyme or protein structure is affected by changes in pH, and that there will be some ideal pH at which the enzyme works most efficiently. And if we go left or right, when we leave that ideal pH, it won't work as effectively. And indeed, at lower and higher pHs, there's probably some enzyme denaturation as well.